Hey everyone, today let's talk about hybrid cloud. Now, by the book, it refers to a cloud computing architecture with two or more environments consisting of public and private clouds, on-premises, and these days even edge environments. But without the right strategy, hybrid cloud can actually pose a number of challenges. Now today, we're going to go through an example to lay out some of those advantages and disadvantages of a fictional distribution company that started to undergo that hybrid cloud transformation process. Now we're going to start with what they have kind of on-premise. Now, right off the bat, let's start with this legacy application that they've got. Now, this is an application that enables their users to get shipment and tracking information, and it continues to work, so they don't really have a good reason to modernize it, although it is kind of running on some legacy, old school, let's say Java EE-based monolithic architecture. In addition, they've also got some customer data that's running on-premise. Now, this is one of the key advantages of hybrid cloud, is that it lets you run workloads where you need them. So in this particular case, to comply with GDPR or maybe some other regulations, they need to keep that data on-premise, which is actually a pretty cool advantage of hybrid cloud that they can continue to do that. Now, they've also got some HR software running on-premise. We're going to call this BPMS, or Business Process Management Software. And this is going to allow their customers to do, or rather their workforce, to do things like requesting time off, or maybe, you know, doing some purchase work orders, that kind of thing. So that's what they've got on-prem. Now, we mentioned that they've started the hybrid cloud transformation. They started to take advantage of cloud native. So let's see what they've done in the public cloud. Now, we've distilled the cloud into kind of three major categories in the past. So infrastructure as a service, platform as a service, and software as a service. Now, let's start with PaaS. And what they've done here is they've taken advantage of a Kubernetes or container-based environment, maybe even something like managed OpenShift running in the cloud, to create a new version of the same application we talked about before, but one that works for mobile users. So mobile backend, as well as a database there that kind of works for mobile users to be able to get tracking and shipment information. But this led to an increased cost and support to maintain all of those users. So they started to take advantage of another service available in the cloud. So here's where SaaS comes in. They took a chatbot and they built it into that application, and that enables them to offset some of that increased support costs. In addition, let's say they're also using some of the SaaS capabilities for IoT, for their delivery drivers, maybe in their warehouses, their distribution centers, that kind of thing. So IoT is helping, you know, track the goods and maybe making sure they're temperature controlled, that kind of thing. And finally, for IaaS, here's an environment that I think kind of benefits from lift and shift. So some of that business process management software that they've got running on-prem, maybe they've migrated some of that software over to the cloud. And I think that's an excellent opportunity to start taking advantage of IaaS is by kind of doing that lift and shift, taking advantage of some of that software and moving it there. Maybe they're also running some CMS systems like WordPress for content management, and they're running that as software on some VMs that are made available through the IaaS capabilities in the cloud. Now, those two environments are integrated together because, you know, they've got some shared data. Obviously, the web interface and the mobile backend are probably using a similar data source. Finally, they've also got edge environments. So these are going to be things like distribution centers. They're called edge environments because they're at the edge. They're where data is being created. And these distribution centers basically enable the customer to do things like kind of run workloads right where the data is being created. So maybe something like Kubernetes, or again, OpenShift, a distribution of Kubernetes to manage the edge workloads where data is really being created. And those are obviously going to be integrated to their on-premise and cloud environments to share data about shipments so their users are getting the latest and greatest information about, you know, where that shipment is. So this is where the company is today, and they've run into a number of challenges. So number one, they have increased complexity. So as they've gone from on-premise to the cloud and all these edge environments, now they have kind of an increased number of environments, so their ops teams have to maintain that. In addition, they need a way to port assets from one environment to another. So far, they haven't necessarily run into any issues, but they're starting to build a chatbot into the mobile backend and say, hey, maybe we should start taking advantage of that on our web application as well. And they're finding they're not able to easily do that. Their DevOps teams are struggling because their assets aren't quite portable, maybe they have multiple vendors they're working with, there isn't that consistency. And the last concern I'll raise is security. More environments, higher surface area of attack, their security team has to kind of invest more resources to help maintain these solutions. So there is a solution to all of this, and it's taking on a unified and open hybrid cloud approach. And that's going to start at the infrastructure layer that we've already talked about a little bit. So that infrastructure layer is going to be things like the on-premises environment. It's going to be public and private cloud environments, as well as edge locations. But here's where the key piece kind of starts to kind of work out. So at the foundational layer, they need to start building some standardization. So here's where they can start building in a consistent operating system. So something like Linux or RHEL or Red Hat Enterprise Linux is going to help here because their developers can work against a single operating system across these multiple environments. And I mentioned RHEL because that brings me to my next point here, the platform layer. And here's where they're going to be running something like Kubernetes. And Kubernetes is great because it gives you that consistent container-based environment that works in any kind of location, on-premise, edge, the cloud. But you can even take it a step further with OpenShift Container Platform, which is going to give you that enterprise-supported approach to containers. And again, it's great because it runs anywhere. Finally, the key to all of this is the solutions. So this consistency and standardization enables customers to focus on standardized solutions across the board. So this can be things like the apps that they're developing, or the data that they need to manage, or even security solutions that they're building across the board. And this is just scratching the surface. There's other use cases here that I'm not even diving into, things like integration, managing these multiple cloud environments, automation, that kind of thing. But this standardized layer and platform enables them to focus on solutions that work across the board. Now, this is going to lead to a number of advantages. Now, the number one thing about hybrid cloud is that it needs to be portable. That means your workloads need to be able to move across environments. Now, we mentioned they've got a monolithic legacy application architecture on-prem. Maybe they start pulling in OpenShift or Kubernetes on-premises, start refactoring into microservices and cloud-native-based applications, and they start having containers for that web interface application. Now, if they want to, they can start porting those assets to the cloud and take advantage of the elasticity there to scale up and down on demand. Number two, it's going to be faster innovation. Now, with that portability, their developers can now think in a new way. They can build once and deploy anywhere. So that chatbot experience they built for the mobile backend, they're going to be able to readily port that to the on-premise experience, to the web user interface experience, the legacy app, if they modernize it to kind of container-based architecture. So that's one of the key advantages. Their developers are going to benefit from faster innovation, reduced time to value, faster go-to-market by taking advantage of the industry's best, you know, DevOps and Agile practices. So that's a key part about a hybrid cloud is faster innovation. And finally, as we mentioned before on the security front, with that standardized layer of that OpenShift or Kubernetes, that container-based environment across the board, you're going to have consistency for things like pushing out compliance policies to these multiple environments. And that's going to be critical here to make sure you have that kind of secure and consistent approach across these multiple environments. Now, in the interest of standardization and standardization across the board and having that kind of consistent layer, imagine if you could handle all of these layers, right? Infrastructure, foundation, and solutions, all from a single, say, public cloud environment. That means extending the public cloud to not just on-premises environment, but maybe even other clouds and the edge. Well, that's when we're starting to get into the concept of distributed cloud. So I urge you to check out my video on that. Now, with hybrid cloud, it's going to be paramount that you take a unified and open approach to truly set yourself up for success. If you enjoyed this video, have any questions, be sure to drop a like or a comment below. Stay tuned and follow us for more videos like this in the future. Thank you.